الحمد لله، الحمد لله خالق الوجود من العدم، وجاعل النور من الظلم، ومخرج الصبر من الألم، وملقي التوبة على الندم. فنشكره على المصائب كما نشكره على النعم، ونصلي على رسوله الأكرم ذي الشرف الأشم والنور الأتم والكتاب المحكم وكمال النبيين والخاتم، سيد ولد آدم، الذي بشر به عيسى ابن مريم، ودعا لبعثته إبراهيم عليه السلام حين كان يرفع قواعد بيت الله المحرم، فصلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى أتباعه خير الأمم الذين بارك الله بهم كافة الناس العرب منهم والعجم. فالحمد لله الذي نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه، ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، ونشهد أن محمدًا عبد الله ورسوله، أرسله الله تعالى بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله، وكفى بالله شهيدًا. فصلى الله عليه وسلم تسليمًا كثيرًا كثيرًا. ثم أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمدٍ صلى الله عليه وسلم، وإن شر الأمور محدثاتها، وإن كل محدثةٍ بدعة، وكل بدعةٍ ضلالة، وكل ضلالةٍ في النار. يقول سبحانه وتعالى في كتابه الكريم بعد نقول أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم: شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن هُدًى للناس وبيِّناتٍ من الهُدى والفُرقان، فمن شهد منكم الشهر فليصمه، ومن كان مريضًا أو على سفر فعدةٌ من أيامٍ أخر، يريد الله بكم اليسر ولا يريد بكم العسر، ولتُكملوا العدة، ولتُكبِّروا الله على ما هداكم ولعلكم تشكرون. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي امري واحلل عقده من لساني يفقه قولي. واللهم ثبتنا عند الموت بلا اله الا الله، واللهم اجعلنا من الذين امنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. امين يا رب العالمين. الحمد لله. I think all of you are aware that the month of Ramadan is approaching very very quickly, and it's time that we use every opportunity we have to remind ourselves and to prepare ourselves as best we can to take full advantage of this month, and not let the opportunity of forgiveness and earning Allah's paradise and starting our life of iman afresh, we don't miss any of those opportunities. And so I thought that this would be a good opportunity to remind myself and my family and you and your family of ways that we can make the most of this Ramadan. That's why I recited the ayah about the month of Ramadan, and the only ayah in the Quran about the month of Ramadan, in the beginning of this khutbah. But instead of describing the entire ayah to you, I want to highlight only the last part of this ayah. Usually in a khutbah we have half an hour or less. And in explaining the beginning of this ayah, it takes so long that by the time you get to the end, you pay very little attention, or the khatib has very little time to pay attention to the treasure at the end of this beautiful long ayah about Ramadan. So my khutbah today, inshaAllah ta'ala, is actually just focusing on the conclusion, these concluding remarks by Allah Azza wa Jalla about the beautiful month of Ramadan. He says, يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ بِكُمُ الْيُسْرِ وَلَا يُرِيدُ بِكُمُ الْعُسْرِ. He wants ease for you. Allah wants ease for you, and He doesn't want difficulty for you. You know, it is enough to say, for someone to say, I want things to be easy for you. You don't have to add on top of that, and I don't want them to be difficult for you. You know, you have to say, I want the food to be delicious, and I don't want it to taste bad. You don't have to say, I don't want it to taste bad. It's already covered when you say, I want it to be delicious. So when Allah says, Allah wants ease for you and me, it's already covered that obviously He doesn't want difficulty. But He goes out of His way to say, وَلَا يُرِيدُ بِكُمُ الْعُسْرِ. And He doesn't want difficulty for you. Why would He do that? Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because this kind of repetitive talk, this kind of saying something and saying the converse of it to convince you even more, it's done in language when the listener isn't convinced. There are some people, as the month of Ramadan is coming closer, they're like, oh man, this is in July this year in Texas. It's gonna be hard. There's that conversation some people are having. Maybe they're not having it with their friends and family, they're having it in their head. And those are the kinds of people Allah is talking to here, and He's saying, look, Allah wants ease for you. He doesn't want difficulty for you. He doesn't like you to be in difficulty. He doesn't enjoy putting you through pain and through hardship and through the heat, and you know, to have you suffer with your thirst and your hunger all day. He doesn't like that for you. That's not what this is. And the other purpose of this, Allah is saying, يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ بِكُمُ الْيُسْرُ وَلَا يُرِيدُ بِكُمُ الْعُسْرُ. There are gifts in this ayah. One of the beautiful gifts in this ayah is, in the month of Ramadan, Allah will make fasting easier than any other time of the year. So if you fast in the month of Ramadan, it will be easy for you. But if you fast outside of the month of Ramadan, and some of you have tried, you will notice it's 10 times harder. Your energy is gone. You're not able to cope. Allah makes special ease for you in this month. And there are several fruits that come from this, just this one statement. And the other is that Allah Azza wa Jalla, by putting us through a little bit of difficulty, what we will get out of the month of Ramadan, the fruits of Iman and Taqwa and the consciousness of Allah and the closeness to Allah and getting away from sins and bad talk and evil. For 30 days we're going to be away from the waswasa of shaitan. It will prepare us to deal with this life so that we don't have to face the real difficulty. The real difficulty will be when we stand in front of Allah. And the people whose month of Ramadan got accepted, they will have ease on Judgment Day because they earned Allah's forgiveness. They're not going to have difficulty on Judgment Day. We pray Allah makes all of us from them. So يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ بِكُمُ الْيُسْرُ وَلَا يُرِيدُ بِكُمُ الْعُسْرُ. But then the next part also, very peculiar. Allah already said, فَمَنْ شَهِدَ مِنْكُمُ الشَّهْرُ فَلْيَصُمْهُ. Then whoever witnesses the month among you, he should fast. So at least in that part of the ayah earlier, Allah told us that this month you have to fast. The entire month. Fine. Now he says, وَلِتُكْمِلُ الْعِدَّةِ. So you complete, so that you could complete the count. If he already said, fast the entire month, what does he mean, complete the count? Is he repeating himself? Is he saying the same thing? Actually, he's saying more now. إِكْمَال in Arabic, لِتُكْمِلُ الْعِدَّةِ. The word إِكْمَال in Arabic comes from كَمَال. And kamal in Arabic doesn't just mean completion. It actually also means perfection, when nothing is left. Allah doesn't just want us to fast in Ramadan. Allah wants us to have a perfect 30 days. A perfect 30 days. It's not just about the fasting. Fasting has already been talked about. But there's more things we have to perfect in these 30 days. And we're working, striving towards perfection in these 30 days. May Allah Azza wa Jalla give all of us ikmal in our month of Ramadan. What does that mean? How do we strive for perfection in these 30 days? What do we have to complete? What is it that is imperfect? You see, we human beings, by nature, by our creation, we make a lot of mistakes. We forget. We don't have perfect salat. We don't have perfect wudu. We don't have perfect fasts. Our eyes are not looking where they're supposed to look. Our tongue doesn't always say what it's supposed to say. But these 30 days, you are striving to fix your tongue. You're working really hard to work on your eyes. You're working really hard to work on your ears. And so we have to, when we talk about وَلِتُكْمِلُ الْعِدَّةِ, we have to pause for a little bit and take some practical advice. And I thought, you know, we hear a lot of times about building taqwa and becoming better people, especially in the month of Ramadan, but I thought I should give some specific advice. I know it's summer vacation and I see a lot of children in the audience. The kids that are here, I'm talking to you first. If your parents have given you an iPod or a mobile device, or you have a portable PlayStation, or you have an Xbox at home or a Wii at home, Ramadan, you get yourself ready from now. No video games in Ramadan. Get yourself ready from now. No games. If you have apps on your phone, delete them. Don't worry, don't cry. Your dad will download them again when Shaitan comes back after Ramadan. But for now, delete the apps. Get rid of them. Get rid of them. No Netflix in Ramadan. No YouTube in Ramadan. Get rid of it. And we start from now. Before we talk about doing good things, we have to stop the damage. We have to stop. Before we do dhikr of Allah, we have to stop the means of ghafla, of heedlessness. The things that distract us from Allah, we have to stop that first. Then we talk about remembering Allah Azza wa Jalla. So now, from now, prepare yourselves. There's going to be 30 good days where you're not going to distract yourself with video games, not with movies, not with cartoons, not with TV episodes, nothing. You're gonna cut it. And if you, the children, are going to cut it, obviously that means the parents and the adults. It goes without saying. And you don't have to watch all the news at home. Don't make the excuse I'm watching the news. Because you're not. And you're not gonna change world events, so just relax. You know? You can read a couple of articles if you're really that interested. But the first thing for the kids, get rid of the video games this month. I'm not saying for life, I know you can't survive, it's like oxygen for some of you. But it's gonna be hard, but do it. This is part of you perfecting this month. The other thing all the children here should do, and the parents should encourage them, all the children here should do this. You should have a goal to memorize a certain amount of Quran this month. that you should have a goal that we're going to memorize every day. We're going to dedicate 1 hour and we're going to memorize Quran. I don't care if you've never memorized before in your life and you're the only, maybe some of you that are sitting here, the only time you come to masjid is Jumu'ah. Maybe the only time you come is Ramadan. I don't care. I don't blame you. I'm just saying, look, this Quran is for every one of us. It's for your family. Whether you come to the masjid or not, the Quran has a right over you and over your children. So you have to make it a point to memorize Quran. Until you guys are on summer vacation, you have the time and shaitan's distraction is not there. So when you sit there and try to memorize with sincerity, you're not going to fall asleep like you normally do. Because shaitan comes and puts you to sleep when you spend time with his book, when you spend time with Allah's book. But he won't do that because he can't. He's chained up in Ramadan. So take advantage of that. Some people don't even know how to memorize. It's not going to be a khutbah about teaching you how to memorize, but there are simple things you can do. Just read one ayah. If you don't know how to recite properly, download a good recitation, a good slow recitation. There are endless all over the web, right? Listen to a recitation of one ayah, read it properly, read it 10 times. Look at it and read it 10 times. Then don't look at it and try to read it 10 times. Then read the next ayah 10 times. Then try to read both of them together 10 times, like that. Look at it and read it 10 times, then don't look at it and read it 10 times. And before you know it, you'll start memorizing Quran. The parents that are here, you should reward your children for memorizing Quran in this month. Now, first of all, you should dedicate a very specific time during the day where they're going to memorize. And then, you should reward them for finishing. And don't reward them with more video games. Give them something good, you know? Take them on a trip. Do something special for Eid, something. But you should set up some encouragement also for your children. So this is at least for the kids. If you can finish and you memorized already, or mashallah, it's not difficult for you, then the additional recommendation I have is for the entire family. This is not just for the children, it's for the entire family. You should make it a point this Ramadan that you're going to learn 20 du'as. And I'm going to try to make that handout this week, so next Jumu'ah they can pass it out in the community, inshallah ta'ala. 20 du'as, coming into the house, leaving the house, walking into the masjid, leaving the masjid, for the bathroom, for eating, for changing your clothes. Just 20 du'as in the month of Ramadan. You know what that will do? It'll help you for the rest of your life. So when you're doing these things daily, you're going to find it easy to remember Allah. We all have those books of du'as, but they have to be in our head and in our heart, not on paper. We have to memorize those du'as, right? So Quran memorization, make that a project for your family, and du'a memorization if you have time. That would be really beneficial for all of you. Now I'm going to turn my attention to the sisters for a little bit. The first advice I'll give you is to spend time with whatever you tell your children to do, you do it yourself too. And sisters, I know your husbands put a lot of pressure on you sometimes to make the most elaborate iftar ever made in human history, but brothers, don't put pressure on the women to cook so much so they're cooking half the day of the fast, they're just cooking. They're just standing in front of the stove cooking and not doing anything else. Have a light iftar. Don't have a heavy iftar. Don't fry foods and, overcook. You cook enough for 10 people and there's 2 people sitting there. This is the month to remember the advice of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when he tells us to fill 1/3 of our stomach. One third for meal, 1/3 for drink, and the other leave the third alone. This is not the month for you to take, you sit 10 minutes before Maghrib, you sit at the table, and you're waiting. You've got a mountain of ketchup on your plate, and you've got the fries and the pakora and the samosa and all of this stuff, and you're just making a mountain of food inside. And by the time you're done with that, you can barely stand up for Maghrib. Most people, it's unfortunate, most Muslims, they end up gaining weight in Ramadan, not losing weight. Eat normal, eat light. Eat light so you have the energy to move around. Don't fill your stomach. That's the training. What's the point of all day of fasting? Allah is training us to be able to do without too much food and then overeat at the end of all of it. It defeats the purpose. And obviously when you have that kind of a state, how in the world are you going to come for Taraweeh? And even if you do, after 2 rak'ahs, you're going to be standing there waiting for the imam. When is he going to go into ruku'? Man, this one's going too long. That's what's going to happen to you. You don't want that to happen. You want to make the most of this month. It has to do with how you will eat, what your schedule will be, how the entire family is motivated to do their best. Everybody has to work hard on this. Everybody does. And not every family is at the same level. MashaAllah, we have a lot of kufal in the community. A lot of people in the community that come for pretty much every prayer. They're here, and there's so many people that are not here. Not everybody's at the same level. But you know what? You have to do better this Ramadan than you did last Ramadan. Your family has to do better this Ramadan than they did last Ramadan. You personally, your children, the wife, everybody. You're not in competition with anybody else. You're in competition with yourself. You have to improve yourself. You have to ask yourself, what did I mess up in Ramadan, and how am I going to fix that this Ramadan? Now, so this is a little bit about the sisters. Also, sisters, even if you are preparing meals, or you're spending a lot of time at home, or you know, busy with other things, try to use that time up either for reciting, reviewing the Quran you've memorized, listening to recitation, listening to tafsir. Explanations of the Quran, whether it's in Urdu, in Arabic, or English, listen to it. Listen to that explanation. I also have advice for the Hufaz that are in the audience. A lot of our Hufaz, mashallah, the only thing they do in Ramadan is prepare for Taraweeh. Right, the only thing on the mind is I gotta review because I gotta lead prayer in front of 10 people or 100 people, 1,000 people. So I just have to review my Quran. And it takes away from the khushu' of Ramadan. Have a dedicated time for review. But also because alhamdulillah you've already memorized the entire Quran, you should be focused on now as much as you can be on trying to understand the Quran. It's a tragedy when we have a generation of people that have memorized the Quran and they don't understand it. This is a month you should try, especially the Hufaz, should go out of their way to read tafsir, read or listen to tafsir, listen to explanation, you know, and really try to internalize what it is that they're reciting. You should have a program of, you know, every year I'm going to study 2-3 juz of tafsir. So over the next 10 years, inshallah, you've studied the entire Quran just in Ramadan. That's especially for the Hufaz. And finally, I want to give some advice to the men that are in the audience. I'll start with the same advice as the kids. Delete the apps off your phone that are useless. Get rid of them. Get rid of the video game apps. Get rid of the Netflix app, the Amazon video player app. Whatever app you have that you use for entertainment, it should be off your device. It should not be there. From now, don't say, first of Ramadan, alhamdulillah, at least I can finish season 5. Don't do that. Be done with it. Be done with it. No more. No more. Allah Azza wa Jalla does not like people who hear a reminder and then they ignore it. And they tell themselves they'll change later. He doesn't like those people. Allah Azza wa Jalla describes those people sometimes in very harsh language. People who hear a reminder and they ignore it. وَمَنْ أَظْلَمُ مِمَّنْ ذُكِّرَ بِآيَاتِ رَبِّهِ فَأَعْرَضَ عَنْهَا. Who could be more wrong? Who could be a worse wrongdoer than someone who was reminded of the ayat of his master and he ignored them? He just went ahead. Like, you know, وَنَسِيَ مَا قَدَّمَتْ يَدَا. He forgot whatever's in front of him. In other words, he was irresponsible even though he or she was reminded. So take it seriously. Get rid of the entertainment input. We have to take in the word of Allah, the advice of our Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam this month. So that means we have to stop the corrupt input. We have to put that to a halt. Even if you can't stop that for your whole life, at least respect this month enough. That's my first advice to the men. The second advice to the men is don't have long nights. If you are coming here for Taraweeh, and you're making salah, extra salawat, but you're not waking up for Fajr, or you're like, I'll miss the suhoor, it's okay, I had a long night. You're missing the point. The fundamental prayers are Fajr and Isha at the masjid. That's your first goal for Ramadan. When you are meeting that goal, then you add other things. Don't socialize after Taraweeh is done. If you're gonna come here, doesn't matter if you come here for 8 or 20 or 4 or 6, I don't care. But if you come here and you're done with prayers, go home and go to sleep. Don't go home and invite people and 2 in the morning you're up and then you barely wake up for suhoor or whatever. Don't do that. Don't do that. Have time, be here for Fajr. And when you're here for Fajr, you say, well, no. I'm just going to stay up all night and come to Fajr. That way I won't miss it. But that way when you're standing here, you're sleeping when you're standing here. You want to have a real salat. The point isn't just to make it to the masjid and stand there. The point is to be able to have khushu' with Allah. Get proper sleep at night and get here in time for salat and enjoy the Fajr. Make it a goal this year when Allah says, وَلِتُكْمِلُوا الْعِدَّةِ, that you should complete the count, that the men in this audience and your boys that are 12 and older especially, bring them with you Fajr and Isha every day. Bring them with you. That's your goal this Ramadan. You're going to make this Ramadan count. That's how you should think. When some of you are commuting, you're coming from different masjids, whatever masjid is close to you, whatever musalla is close to you, Fajr and Isha, Fajr and Isha, Fajr and Isha. Why? Because the Rasul of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us that if someone makes the prayer of Fajr and Isha and Fajr in Jama'ah, then it's like they prayed the entire night. And why would we miss out on being counted for praying the entire night in the month of Ramadan? And can you imagine? The Laylatul Qadr will come in that too. So even if you didn't catch Laylatul Qadr, you caught it by virtue of the words of the Prophet ﷺ because you made Fajr and Isha in the masjid. Why would you miss on that opportunity? So make that a point. This is going to be a special month for all of us. Let's put ourselves to work. Let's change ourselves. Let's really make it special. So Allah sees we take special, make a special occasion for ourselves and our families to take care of the month of Ramadan. So Allah says, وَلِتُكْبِلُوا الْعِدَّةِ. Then He says, وَلِتُكَبِّرُوا اللَّهَ عَلَى مَا هَدَاكُمْ. So that you can declare Allah's greatness the way He guided you, based on how He guided you. Now this means many things, but at least one thing I'll highlight to you by means of an example. If I was an employee, if I just got a job, and my job was maybe two things I have to do. I have to answer the phone, I have to answer the emails. That's my only job. That's all I have to do. And I decide, well, maybe I should make some photocopies, maybe I should help out in the front desk or whatever. I don't do my real job, I just start doing this extra stuff. And my boss comes up back and says, why aren't you answering the phone? Well, I thought this was kind of important too, and that was important too. You think I'm going to keep my job? No. I was hired for a very particular reason. My priorities, I don't decide what the priority is. They're already given to me by my boss. My boss tells me this is the most important thing, this is the most important thing. Whatever he says is important is important. Whatever he says is not important is not important. He decides, I don't decide. Why am I saying that? Because we declare Allah's greatness. Allah is greater, and Allah sets the priorities based on how He guided us. عَلَى مَا هَدَاكُمْ. You and I don't decide what the priorities are. For some people, the only priority in Ramadan, the only priority is fasting. Sometimes the only priority is socializing. Whose iftar are we going to tonight? That's the only priority. Who sets the priorities? What makes this month important? If you don't get to go to anybody's house in Ramadan and you still do your prayers right, you fix yourself, you get closer to Allah's book, then you've got the right set of priorities. But if you keep socializing at people's homes and missing salawat, and you just had a great, it was just 30 days of parties, Muslim parties, of different people's houses, and you barely made it to the masjid for Fajr, then what's the point? What are you doing? Who are you kidding? لِتُكَبِّرُ عَلَى مَا هَدَاكُمْ. So you make Allah the priority. You declare Allah's greatness the way He guided you, not the way you think you should do it, the way He says you should do it. And then the final piece, وَلَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ. In these 3-4 minutes I have left with you, I want to share with you a brief experience I had recently. I just came back last night from a small village in Mexico. A small village in Mexico became the families, 14 families or so, they're Muslim. Alhamdulillah, they became Muslim recently. And they are living in the most incredibly poor conditions you can imagine. I mean, this is a 2-hour flight from here. Mexico City is a 2-hour flight from here. Another hour and a half flight was to this village of Chiapas in Mexico. And when I go there, we go there, the car cannot go more than 5 miles an hour because if it goes any faster, the tires will bust. You would think you're some a village in Pakistan or Bangladesh or something, but you're right here. You're right here in South America, right here. And you go to these people, subhanAllah, some of you have shacks in your backyard that are better than their homes. The homes they have is just planks of wood, and you can see outside through them. So they put plastic, like garbage bags, so the rain doesn't come in on the walls. The entire house is not even 10 foot by 10 foot. That's the house with a husband, wife, and 4 children. The floor is dirt. The floor is dirt. The kitchen is a corner. There's a stove, like a portable stove with a gas tank on the side. That's their kitchen. The bathroom is outside. There's another shack they built. That's their bathroom. And when it rains, they get wet while they're taking a shower. That's their situation. That's how these people live. Yet you will find they're the happiest people I've ever met in my life. Their children are the happiest children I've ever seen in my life. They were so grateful for every little thing. And you know, for dinner, they slaughtered a lamb, and we cooked it, and the whole 14, 15 families got together, and we ate it in the small masjid that they have. We should be grateful for this masjid, by the way. Their masjid isn't even the size of our shoe area. Okay? That's their masjid. And they're very happy with their masjid. They're very happy with their masjid. And they go, when we're sitting inside and we're eating food, and subhanAllah, they don't eat a lot. They don't eat a lot. So they ate little, and a lot of kids had leftover. A lot of children couldn't finish their food, parents couldn't finish their food. They had plastic bags that they wash and reuse. They put the meat back in the bags because they're going to have it tomorrow. They didn't throw one thing away. Not one thing was thrown away. Why am I saying that to you and me? Because Ramadan is coming. And wallahi, the thing that hurts is that we go and we celebrate and there's so much food thrown away. So much left over. And it's just plastic cups everywhere. People drinking half a bottle of water and chucking it. People eating, leaving a date, oh, it's a date from somebody else's plate, throw it in the garbage. Fruit lying around. We have no appreciation for what Allah gives us. Allah says at the end of the ayah of Ramadan, لَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ. So you could be grateful. You call this grateful? Grateful means you save everything. Grateful means you don't throw anything useful away. Grateful means you don't have bags and bags and bags of garbage, but they're not full of garbage. They're full of good food. That's not right. That's not acceptable by any standard. Don't waste food in Ramadan. Don't put more in your plate than you can eat. Always put less. If you run out, take a little bit more. If you run out, take a little bit more. Some of you have bad habits from where you come from. When you go to a wedding or something, you fill up your plate as much as possible because the next guy might get some food and you won't get second chance. Don't think like that. Don't think like that. Just take a little bit of food, finish it, and then go back and get some more. And this is part of the lesson of Ramadan. Because Allah says, Allah gave us this month so we can be grateful. وَلَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ. And the highest form of ingratitude is wasting the gifts of Allah. That's a serious matter. We have to take this matter seriously. So I pray that, and by the way, sisters, when you make iftar in the morning, and you cook something, or some suhoor in the morning, you cook something, and the family wasn't able to finish it, well, they're gonna have that for iftar. Don't throw it away. Don't throw it away. Don't throw the roti from the morning away. Don't throw the half bread away. Don't throw the milk away. Don't throw that stuff away. Don't say, oh, we're gonna have a new meal in the evening. No, no, no. Be grateful for what the rizq Allah has given you. So don't say to yourself, I can afford it. I can handle it. That rizq isn't yours and mine. And if we don't show gratitude, Allah takes away. You know? Allah says if we're grateful, He'll give us more. لَإِن شَكَرْتُمْ لَأَزِيدَنَّكُمْ. If we're not grateful, we better watch out. وَلَإِن كَفَرْتُمْ إِنَّ عَذَابِي لَشَدِيدٌ. So may Allah Azza wa Jalla really help us become the people that we're supposed to be this Ramadan, and really make this Ramadan a means by which we are changed, we become better people, we become closer to Allah, we really learn to declare Allah's greatness, we come closer to the Quran. I pray our entire family, all of us, my family, your family, by the time Ramadan is done, we know a little bit more about the Quran, we've memorized a little bit more of the Quran, we know a little bit more dua, we're coming closer and closer to Allah and closer to this book, practically speaking. I pray that Allah Azza wa Jalla helps all of our families do that. I make dua that Allah helps all of us, gives all of us the rizq to be able to see this blessed month and to catch the night of power, the night Laylatul Qadr. May Allah Azza wa Jalla, use this month of Ramadan as an excuse to forgive all of our sins and the sins of our families. And may Allah Azza wa Jalla help the state of the Muslims wherever they may be. One last thing I forgot to mention before I close, I'll share it with you. Alhamdulillah, a few weeks ago I was invited to an event here in Dallas by an organization called Ma'roof. And they have sponsored some families from Syria that are here, that are in DFW, that have been brought up under asylum. And these are families that are completely plucked away from their homes. And they're gonna have Ramadan here in Dallas. You know, one of the things you can do, take the name down, Ma'roof. Even if you misspell it, Google it, you'll find it, Ma'roof Dallas. Right, contact those people, invite the family over for iftar at your house. Invite them. Those are Muslims that have been taken away from their homes. Our job is to be brothers and sisters to them, for our kids to play with their kids, right? And if you can invite them, go to them. Go to them. And when you buy your children gifts for Eid, buy them gifts for Eid. Do that for them. Because these are our family. This is one ummah. That we see, especially if Allah has given us the gift of those people that are in need, they come to our city, then we're not helping them, they're honoring us. Because on Judgment Day, when we show brotherhood to them, maybe Allah will forgive us because of the goodness we show to them. They are our ticket to Jannah. They are the honor. We're not honoring them, we're not giving them any favor. They're doing us a favor by letting us do good to them. May Allah Azza wa Jalla help the situation of the Muslims everywhere they may be, especially in places like Syria. May Allah Azza wa Jalla help Islam wherever it may be. May Allah Azza wa Jalla allow our children and our next generation to be carriers of this beautiful deen. Barakallahu li wa lakum fil Qur'an al-Hakim wa nafa'ni wa iyyakum bil ayat wa dhikr. الحمد لله وكفاء والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى، خصوصا على أفضلهم وخاتم النبيين محمد الأمين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. يقول الله عز وجل في كتابه الكريم بعد أن أقول أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم: إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي، يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين، إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين، إنك حميد مجيد. عباد الله رحمكم الله، اتقوا الله، إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر، ولذكر الله أكبر، والله يعلم ما تصنعون. أقم الصلاة، إن الصلاة كانت على المؤمنين كتابا موقوتا.